Welcome everyone. In this lecture, we are going to see the space segment axis. As already in the previous lecture, we have been familiar with the satellite axis methods. That is, in that we have seen some of the introductory part, like for the types of axis methods, single axis methods, multiple axis methods. In that, the frequency division multiple axis, time division multiple axis. For the different types of multiplexings also we have seen, and in the introductory part also we have seen about the pre-assigned methods, that is for the fixed or for the heavy route traffic, what kind of assignments methods we can utilize, or for thin traffic which type of assignments methods we can apply here. That we have seen that pre-assigned FDMAs as well as the demand access assignment methods also we have seen here, that is DAMA, demand assignment multiple access methods. So in that we have seen that the SPADE system is similar to the single channel per carrier pulse code modulation multiple access demand assignment equipment. So in this lecture we are going to see the SPADE system. The word SPADE is the acronym for single channel per carrier pulse code modulated multiple access demand assignment equipment. SPADE was developed by COMSAT for use on the Intelsat satellite and is compatible with the Intelsat single channel per carrier pre-assigned systems. The distributed demand assignment facility requires a common signaling channel, CSC. The common signaling channel bandwidth is 160 kHz and its center frequency is 18.045 MHz below the pilot frequency. That we will going to see with the help of the figure. And to avoid the interference with the common signaling channel, voice channels 1 and 2 are left vacant. That already also in the previous lecture we have seen that the side bands of the pilot frequency has been kept vacant for the to avoid the interference here and to maintain the duplex matching, so that the corresponding channels 1 and 2 are also left vacant here. In this we can see this is the center frequency, which is the pilot frequency, and 400 and 401, these two channels are kept vacant here. Similarly, channel 401 and 402, these are also kept vacant to avoid the interference here. This is the SC, what we see is for channeling. And the channels, if we consider, that is for duplexing, channel 400 also must be left vacant here. And this requires that channel 800 be left vacant for duplex matching. That is, here we can see, as 400 is kept vacant, channel 800 is also kept vacant for the duplex matching. These six channels, that is 400, channel 1, 2, 800, and here is this is 2. These six channels are removed from the total of 800 channels, and leaving then how much will be left is the total of 794 one-way channels will be left. Or if it is the full duplex voice circuits, there may be 397 channels will be left. The frequencies in any pair being separated by, here the frequency separation is 18.045 MHz. As we can see here is for the channel 3, and this channel 403, there is the separation of 18.045 MHz between the two channels. So accordingly, again for this channel, and this is pilot frequency, these are again separated by 18.045 MHz frequency. The total transponder bandwidth is given is 36 MHz, whereas here for the single channeling we can see the 160 kHz is the frequency given. Okay, and we know that this is the common signaling channel, CSC, is for which we have given the 160 kHz bandwidth. So in the SPADE systems, All the earth stations are permanently connected through the common signaling channel, and for six earth stations that we can rename them as A, B, C, D, E and F, that each earth station has the facility for generating any one of the 794 carrier frequencies using frequency synthesizers that we can do with the help of phase lock loops. Where we can design the frequency synthesizer with the help of phase lock loops. Each earth station has a memory containing a list of the frequencies currently available, and this list is continuously updated through the common channeling signals. So to illustrate the process, suppose that a call to station F is initiated from the station C, and station C will first select a frequency pair at random from those currently available on the list and signal this information to station F through the common signal channeling. Okay, so what we are going to do here is channel C will select a frequency pair randomly from the available list, and then it will be sent to the station F through the common channel signaling channel. So this is the pool we can see here. This is the common signal channeling, and where what we are going to do is C will initiate the signal and it will send to the channel F. So this is the representation of a spared communications system, how this will be work here. So we can see that every signal will come to the pool, and from pool we can communicate to the any other five stations from one of these earth station. Like there are six stations A, B, C, D, E, F, so they can select the frequency from the available frequency list and they can generate the signal for the other earth stations to which it has to be communicate. So station F must acknowledge through the common channel signaling that it can complete the circuit. Once the circuit is established, the other earth stations are instructed through the common signal channeling to remove this frequency pair from the list. Means once there is a communication between C and F, that frequency will be removed from the list and that could not be utilized by the other earth stations, and they are instructed such that they could not use the same frequency. The round trip time between the station C initiating the call and station F acknowledging it is about 600 milliseconds. So this is the total time required here when C will initiate a call and F will acknowledge it. So during this time, the two frequencies chosen at station C may be assigned to another circuit. It may happen that whatever the frequency that will be selected by C may be assigned to the another circuit. In this event, C will receive the information on the common signal channeling update and will immediately choose the another pair at random. So even before hearing back from the station F, so that again it will go for the another frequency and then it will again try to call. So once a call has been completed and the circuit is disconnected, the two frequencies are again returned to the pool. The information again being transmitted to the common signal channeling to all the other stations. So establishing the connection through the satellite, the common signaling channel passes signaling information from the calling station to the destination station, from station C to the station F. Signaling information in the spared system is routed through the common signaling channel rather than being sent over a voice channel. Each earth station has equipment called the demand assignment signaling and switching, that is DASS unit, which performs the functions required by the common signaling channel. So that will be available with all the earth stations which are connected in a pool, that are A, B, C, D, E and F. So all will have the equipment which is DASS, demand assignment signaling and switching unit, so that it can perform similar to the common signaling channel. Some type of multiple access to the common signaling channel must be provided for all the earth stations using the spared system. So this is quite separate from the SCPC multiple access of the networks, WISE circuits. So we know that SCPC is single channel per carrier that we have used earlier the term. The time division multiple access is used for this purpose and allowing up to 49 earth stations to access the common signaling channel. As we have seen in the example, only 6 earth stations we utilized, but near about 49 earth stations we can utilized we can use to access the common signaling channel. So this is all about what we have seen, the SPAD system. So the next term that we want to see here is the bandwidth limited and power limited TWT amplifier operation, that is traveling wave tube amplifier operation. A transponder will have a total bandwidth of BTR, we consider this, and it is apparent that this can impose a limitation on the number of carriers which can access the transponder in an FDMA mode. For example, if there are K carriers, each of bandwidth B, then the best that can be achieved is K is equal to BTR by B, where BTR is total bandwidth and B is the bandwidth of carrier. So any increase in the transponder effective isotropic radiated power will not improve on this, and the system is said to be bandwidth limited. That is, likewise for the digital systems, the bit rate is determined by the bandwidth, which again will be limited to some maximum value by BTR. So power limitations occurs where the effective isotropic radiated power is insufficient to meet the carrier to noise ratio requirements. The signal bandwidth will be approximately equal to the noise bandwidth, and if the EIRP is below a certain level, the bandwidth will have to be correspondingly reduced to maintain the C by N at the required value. So now we are going to see the sub point for this amplifier operation, that is FDMA downlink analysis, to see the effects of intermodulation noise which results with frequency division multiple access operation. We have to consider the overall carrier to noise ratio in terms of noise power rather than noise power density. So already we know that the equations for carrier to noise ratio overall is 1 by C by N is equal to 1 by C by N of uplink plus 1 by C by N of downlink plus 1 by C N of the 1 by C by N of intermediate frequencies. So that will be reduces to N by C overall is equal to N by C of uplink, N by C of downlink plus N by C of IN, that is intermediate. So a certain value of carrier to noise ratio will be needed as specified in the system design, and this will be denoted by the subscript of REQ, that is required here. The overall carrier to noise ratio must be at least as great as the required value. A condition which can therefore be stated as the N by C required should be greater than or equal to N by C overall. That is, overall C by N must be at least great as required value. So what we are denoting as N by C required is greater than or equal to N by C overall. So this is our next equation. Now note that because the noise to carrier ratio rather than the carrier to noise ratio is involved here, what we are denoting is N by C, noise to carrier ratio rather than carrier to noise ratio. The actual value is equal to or less than the required value. That is, first equation we have is the condition now, that is C by N by C of overall is equal to N by C of uplink plus N by C of downlink plus N by C of intermediate frequencies. So that what is our requirement is actual value is equal to or less than the required. So we can define noise to carrier ratio required is greater than equal to N by C of uplink plus N by C of downlink plus N by C of IN. the right hand side from this equation is usually dominated by the downlink ratio. With FDMA, back off is utilized to reduce the intermodulation, that is noise, to an acceptable level, and the uplink noise contribution is usually very very less, negligible. Thus the expression that can be approximated as our equation here is from 3, as we are considering that the intermodulation noise is to an acceptable level and uplink noise contribution is negligible. Expression will reduce to, the expression can be approximated as n by c require is greater than equal to n by c downlink, or n it is c by n of required is less than equal to c by n of downlink. So initially we defined noise to carrier ratio, or when we are representing in terms of carrier to noise ratio, required is less than equal to carrier to noise ratio of downlink. So considering these situations where each carrier of the FDMA system occupies a bandwidth B and has a downlink power denoted by EIRP down, then this equation can be reduced to C by N of downlink is equal to EIRP of downlink plus G by T ratio of downlink minus losses minus K minus B, where B is the bandwidth. Where it is assumed that Bn is approximately B. This can be written in terms of the required carrier to noise ratio, and that we can write as required carrier to noise ratio is less than equal to EIRP of downlink plus G by T of downlink minus the losses during the downlink minus K minus B. So to set up a reference level, consider first single carrier operation. The satellite will have a saturation value of EIRP and a transponder bandwidth BTR, both of which are assumed to fixed. With single carrier access, no back off is needed. So our equation of carrier to noise ratio required is less than equal to EIRPS plus, that is for satellite, saturation value of EIRP, plus G by T of downlink minus losses minus K minus BTR, as bandwidth is BTR. Or we can write in different way as C by N required minus EIRP of saturated value of satellite, EIRP saturated value of satellite minus G by T of downlink plus losses plus K plus BTR is less than equal to 0. If the system is designed for single carrier operation, then the equality sign applies and the reference condition is, this condition will going to change here. So this is C by N required minus EIRPS minus G by T of D plus losses minus K plus BTR is equal to 0, because of it is used for single carrier. Consider now the effect of power limitation imposed by the need for backoff. Suppose the FDMA access provides for K carrier which share the output power equally and each requires a bandwidth B. The output power for each of the FDMA carriers is EIRP downlink is equal to EIRP, that is saturated value, minus BO backoff power minus K. The transponder bandwidth BTR will be shared between the carriers, but not all of BTR can be utilized because of the power limitation. Let A represent the fraction of the total bandwidth actually occupied such that KB is equal to ABTR, or in terms of decilogs we can write in different way, that is B is equal to alpha plus BTR minus K. So for the downlink analysis, in FDMA downlink analysis, if we substituting these relationships in the equation 6, as we have seen, the required carrier to noise ratio is less than equal to EIRP saturated value minus BO of overall back off power plus G by TD minus losses minus K minus BTR minus alpha. So it will be noted that K term cancels out. the expression can be rearranged as C by N require minus EIRP saturated of energy by TD plus losses plus K plus BTR is less than equal to BO overall minus alpha. But as what we have equation number 9, we'll see that equation number 9 is C by N required is EIRPS minus G by T down plus losses plus K plus BTR is equal to 0. Now from this, the left hand side is equal to 0 if the single carrier axis is used as reference, and hence this left hand side will become equal to 0. So that what is this left hand side will become equal to 0. So 0 is less than equal to minus BO of overall minus alpha, or alpha is less than equal to minus BO overall. So the best that can be achieved is to make A is equal to alpha is equal to minus BO overall, and since the back off is a positive number of decibels, A must be negative or equivalent as a fractional. It means that we know that here this is back off power is positive, so that A will become negative, or equivalently this can be written as a fraction. So this is what we have seen about the SPADE systems and FDMA downlink analysis. Regarding the we have calculated the required carrier to noise ratio when we are using the FDMA downlink systems. Again, for the bandwidth, we have seen that is limited bandwidth when utilized, we calculated the downlink analysis for FDMA. In the next lecture, we are going to see the other parameters, that is for TDMA and all the other multiple access techniques. Thank you.